Hey guys, we're back. We have John Petrucci here from Dream Theater, and now we are talking Boogies.
I'm still here. I'm not
You're still here. If you want to check the first video which we made, which was about all the Ernie Ball Music Man products, you can find the video on our channel, Thomann Music, and you can subscribe. It's somewhere there on the right corner. Let's start.
Yes.
Let's talk Boogies. First of all, can you please say the word Boogie?
Boogie.
I love how you say boogie. It sounds so boogie. I love it. It's how they sound, actually.
That's how they sound. That's the mojo behind it.
So, yes. You have your beautiful and awesome looking and sounding signature head. What can you tell about this?
Well, first of all, it still freaks me out that I look at it and my signature is on it because, absolutely. You know, I can't, I'm not sure what that equates to. You know, it's like having, what if you had your name on a BMW?
Oh my God, Mercedes. Of course, cars. Oh.
You had the Kris.
Like the BMW. Kris signature BMW.
You'd be M6. Looking at it like, what? How did that happen?
It would still freak me out after years, yeah.
Well, to me, that's what this is. Like, you know, I've been playing Boogie for ever and ever and ever. When I first discovered the amp, you know, when I was younger, at a music store, and a guy said, if you want to play a real amp, you got to play a Boogie. and it was all over from there. And I owned, you know, kind of every incarnation I can get my hands on.
Okay.
You know, from quad preamps, studio preamps, rectifiers, Mark II.
You played the triamps.
The Triaxis, you know, 2C Plus, of course, which is this what this is modeled after. Mark IVs. Lone Stars, Road Kings, Mark III. This is your Mark III.
Yeah, man.
Thanks for bringing that in.
Yeah, sure. I just wanted to give him a little mojo. You know,
yeah. It's part of the, part of the family. Yeah. And so I had a lot of experience with Boogies, and they're on every Dream Theater record, on my solo record, Liquid Tension Experiments. It's always a Boogie. Of course, I played the Mark V, which is the more recent one. There it is.
Which is here behind me.
Right, which is a great amp. You know, has a C plus mode in it. That amp kind of gave me the idea and the hope that
it's possible.
you can have three channels on an amp to get like the three sounds you know, are the basic sounds: clean, heavy, crunch, rhythm, and a lead sound.
Yeah.
Using it live, which I was, and I needed to do this, that, or the other thing. Well, I would need a second Mark V for that. Because there's only one EQ.
Ah, sure.
You know, well, I wish the second channel was like the third channel, but it's not. It's different. It would be cool if channel 2 could be the same as channel 3.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. So when it came to the design of the JP2C, those were the two things, is that I wanted it to be a real bona fide reissue of a C+.
All right.
Because they had never done one. So let's do it for real. Let's use the same circuit. Let's get the big ass heavy transformer that they use back.
I actually looked in it. It's big as my head.
Exactly.
It's like this high.
Right. You know, let's make this be, you know,
proper. Yeah.
Exactly. And at the same time, let's use what Randy had learned from the design of the Mark V and everything incorporated into here.
Yeah.
So you can see there's a similarity, you know, between the three channel
the layout
and the kind of knobs and everything like that. But let's take it to the next level. So we have clean, we have two lead channels that are essentially the same.
Okay.
It would be like the lead channel on a C+. The second one has a slightly more gain, basically.
Okay.
Two EQs instead of one, because two is better than one.
Use more than one.
Right, and you can assign any of these EQs to any channel.
All right.
So this was perfect for me. Now these are the settings that you dialed in very expertly. And you did it in such a way where you set the EQ that you're using on channel 2 differently than the one you're using on channel 3, because you have this one set up as a crunch sound, this one set up as a lead sound.
Yep.
And so that kind of flexibility was really very important to me. I had to do that with an amp switcher because we didn't have the different EQs. You know, I needed that many, I wanted, you know, to be able to have that flexibility to play the songs that we recorded. Yeah. I kind of needed those three channels. So this amp does it in one amp. Some things that are different, you know, from the original C+'s that, you know, we did to modernize this amp. Is you know, this is a good thing to have here, because there's all different options where you can pull the shift the bass, you can pull the master,
like change frequencies, which change it.
Well, the idea was that with every C plus I've ever owned, I always set it this certain way.
Okay.
And it turns out that most players do as well. Like, who doesn't pull the master deep? Who wants a wimpy sound? So what we did is we made the decisions, you know, that most guys, and especially myself, since it was my signature amp, do, and we put that in. So you don't have those pull things here. They're set. Yeah. They're set the way
as good as it
to gets. Optimize the amp. Yeah. Having said that, we did add some new pull features, which are really cool. And the story behind it is that this amp was being prototyped when I was in the studio for the last album, The Astonishing. So I had a couple of different prototypes, and I couldn't decide on two things. One was the amount of gain, because I kept saying, oh, it'd be great to have a C-plus that had more gain. And Doug at Boogie, Doug West, was very kind of like, well, you know, you got to be careful because too much gain, it gets flubby and non-musical. And so we were kind of going back and forth. And a similar story with the presence, where normal Boogie presence has a certain sound to it that's classic, has that cutting high end. And through some kind of happy accident, as Randall Smith would say, they stumbled upon this other presence frequency that was kind of lower in range, and that they fell in love with. So I had two different prototypes and we couldn't decide. And so it was like, well, why can't we do both?
Yeah,
you know, it might even been Maddie that said, "What can we do?" But you know, it was like, "We'll do pull pots."
Yeah, yeah.
So on channels 2 and 3, gain pushed in is normal, like where you would set this sort of first volume and lead drive to the optimal sound. Pulled out is slightly more gain.
All right.
And for Boogie files, again, it's like maybe it went from 7.5 to like 8.
Okay.
Like just silly things that make a difference. Yeah. And with the presence control pulled is like old school C plus. And I'll demonstrate that in a second.
Yeah.
And then pushed is the kind of lower presence, which is maybe less high endy, maybe more in the 1K zone.
Okay.
Something like that.
It's not so harsh, so you can go a little higher.
You would set it higher. Setting. Yeah. Okay. The C pluses and Mark III, like you said, you'd have the presence on like 1.
Yeah.
A C plus, maybe you'd have it on like 3.
Okay.
3.5, 4 if you really
want to. Sure, because they're a little warmer, you told. Yeah. Like in comparison to Mark III.
Exactly.
They were more balanced.
More balanced, right. And channel 3 is just slightly more gain.
All right.
Just a little bit more for that lead sound.
Exactly.
Right? You want the if you wanted to, you can literally just match them and they'd be the same. There's a shred feature.
Yeah, I wanted to ask
you,
do you actually use that?
I use it, yes.
And when and how?
Okay, so the idea with the shred feature was that I found when recording and laying down guitar tracks, we'd get like a pretty bold, chunky, heavy sound.
Yeah.
But when the album was in its mix processed, there's certain things that a mix engineer would do to give the guitar, especially if you're playing 7-string or lower tunings, to give the guitar more room.
Okay.
So it doesn't interfere with the bass.
All right.
And to give it more cut so that it kind of has this hair on it. And that hair is probably like in a 3K range.
All right.
So I was like, how could we put that on the amp? and so Randy came up with this voicing, and we called it shred, and it kind of shifts the emphasis to like the upper mid harmonics. And it gives the, I guess it is adding some gain, but it's like the impression of gain.
All right.
And it the way that I use it is not, it sounds like shred. Oh, when you're playing fast, you'd put it on. No, it's for when you're playing like chunky low rhythms or lines and you want more clarity in the band. You know, on some of the albums, like maybe I use a Mark IV, and I want to kind of get more of that sort of sound, which might be a little more scoopy, like something like... So that I might even pull that more, maybe? It's, the Mark IVs were a little gainier. Yeah. that's Dark Eternal Night, the ending of that song.
Yeah, yeah.
Big guitar riff, put on shred. You listen to what it does. It just brings out this kind of metal,
all right.
definition thing.
It's some like a mastering.
Yeah,
knob,
it's a little mastering
mixed
knob.
With a little bit of a tight knob,
yes,
or something, yeah, like a mixture of those.
Totally.
All right.
Totally. In fact, what it originally, when I heard it, it took, when you pop it in, it takes a little bit of the low end out.
All right.
And I was like, it makes sense. But at the time, I was like, well, I don't really want it to do that because I don't want to lose low end.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Randall was like, well, think about it. You know, if you want to create that space, that's the perfect thing. It's like, yeah, you're absolutely right. A couple of other quick things. The amp is the first Boogie to have MIDI built in, and it also has a cab clone built into it. So it is the ultimate amp of
all
time.
All in, all in. Yeah.
Yeah. So these are the sounds that you dialed in here. You obviously know your stuff as far as Boogie. The clean sound, what I was going for is the cleanest of clean. I didn't want it to break up. I'm not like that kind of player where I like the pushed sound. Yeah. You can do it if you are that kind of player. Have no fear.
Yeah, sure.
You know, you just need to turn the middle up past 5.
Oh, come on.
And it'll do that.
Does it give you more of a gain?
I would normally, so like I said before, like my clean approach, right, is I'm playing arpeggiated chords like that. I don't want breakup. That's the sound. And we got to put on our friend, our Dreamscape, right? Yeah, there you go. Beautiful. That's the vibe I go for. So if you can do it differently. So if we wanted to,
how would you set it?
You know what? You're like right on. I might. That sounds beautiful. So maybe I'll keep it that way. I might. Sometimes I'll pull more middle out.
Okay.
And just what we were talking about, where it sounds great here, it might be too thick for front of house. So sometimes I'll have to back that bass down a little bit.
Okay.
Maybe make it slightly brighter. And so it's going to be a little more transparent. In the grand scheme of the band mix, that will create the space necessary.
Yeah, yeah.
The sound you had dialed sounded richer.
For a lull in the room,
which is great. Yeah. But if you want like that other kind of sound, let's say you turn the master down, you kind of crank that, get the mid up past, you know. Maybe shut off the chorus there. Starting to get that sound.
It's tight, but it gets this hairy, gainy sound.
Right. Cool. Now, I guess if you wanted to. It's not like death punch or anything. But I suppose if you were like, you know.
It's more of a fusion jazz kind of super clean, hairy.
And you did have an overdrive pedal, right? You probably would be able to get it to that.
Yeah.
You know, if you needed.
Wow, I never ever thought that it's possible because wherever I heard this channel in videos or myself even, I never experimented with the mids.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, that's clean. That's so clean. Right. Doesn't matter what you have, like active pickups or singer coils. It will stay clean, but
it's a cool feature. It's something
it's nice
that
show, then.
I'm not sure when they started doing that. If that was maybe a feature of the Mark 525, maybe.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, when you go past 12 o'clock on the middle, you can get those sounds. The channel 2, you have it set for a very tight kind of front. Right. Now that's like the boogie thing, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Super, super exactly. Exact. Yeah.
So we go back to a change of season so that. That kind of thing is where that sound would come into play. Now, I would dial it close to where you have it, maybe get a little bit more aggressive.
Okay.
One of the things you know from being a Boogie owner, when you turn up the gain higher, you kind of need to back down the bass. Otherwise, it can get flubby. We don't want
exactly.
flub.
Exactly.
We want tightness. And you can do the same thing with the middle. As you bring that down, it'll get a little tighter.
Oh, right.
It gets a little bit thicker as you go up.
It's more vintagey.
Yeah. And treble, you know, you can almost, like with these controls, if you listen closely, you can almost hear what it does without even playing.
Pushes the gain right on.
So you're pushing the gain, actually.
Yeah.
So I might go a little higher gain. Let's see if we go classic boogie. We'll pull it, set that lower.
Right.
And then on your EQ, now this is something interesting. You're pulling down the 240
to get a little
more definition, which is awesome. Let's see where we're at so far. Let's see. Do if we want to thicken it up, let's just go add some pick attack, maybe thicken it up. All right, so this is all if you want to get really aggressive, you can.
It's actually really interesting. I've seen many videos of you, interviews and live videos, of course.
Yeah.
You cannot really tell how hard you pick, but you actually have quite a nice and dynamic right hand.
You try to...
That's
exactly.
I mean, you hear that, but now it makes sense because now I also see it. You know, how your pick is like more like a...
You know, right, exactly. And the kind of picks I use, they're hard, made of Altex, and they're going to give you that definition. This is the Dunlop signature pick, this particular one. They have two different models. This is the first one. But they're going to give that defined sound.
The clarity.
And the clarity, exactly. So, and we talked about this even with action and setup.
Yeah.
You know, if the action's a little bit higher, these strings have more room to kind of resonate, and you can pick harder and get that kind of volume and that definition. And now it's getting, I'm getting somewhere. Let's see, this is another thing I'll sometimes do in the studio is the opposite there.
All right.
Yeah. So it's kind of like gives a more creamy, more of a creamy vibe. And if we increase this, let's see, how much gain do we want? That's so boogie. You hear that kind of, you know, when you choke down on the strings, right, that middle. That's the shit right there.
Sick.
And that's, you know, that's boogie. That's something only a boogie does. That's a C-plus signature thing. That's what it does. And so, as you can see, there's all different variations of how you can just sit there and tweak.
These are so small differences, and it reacts super, super unique right away.
And then the lead channel is, it's really a clone of this channel with slightly more gain. So when you set this up, let's put that delay back on,
because
most of the times when I play lead lines, I use a delay. And what you have done here is you've kind of, you're warming up the sound a bit.
Yeah, yeah.
Because when you go into a lead sound, you don't want it to be like
super
knives.
Sharp. Yeah,
exactly. And you want it to be liquidy and do all the great things that, that Boogie is known for. So that's how you have it dialed in. You added some mids. And let's see where you're starting here. I like this, going with your setting. For sure.
What would you?
I might turn that back a little bit.
All right.
The gain thing. This is a Doug thing. Like he likes really low to get that dynamic sense. But sometimes for sustain, I need a little higher there.
Okay.
So you kind of like you maybe back that thing off. I don't know if I use as many mids.
Okay.
Might be a little cloggy, and maybe get the bass a little higher. And I would actually probably pull that down.
Okay.
Instead. Okay. Maybe get some fatness? I don't know. I could be totally wrong right now. Let's see. I don't know. Kris, you might have nailed it. Let's see. And the presence, you're right in backing that down for sure.
Okay.
Yeah. Pretty cool too.
This has some like a violin touch
to it.
Super singing.
And like, that's probably good for like the picking, like if you. And you're able to do those long kind of melody lines too, right?
Super sweet.
Awesome. Anyway, that's the JP2C in a nutshell. and it's all, you know, tons of sounds in between, you know, and any of the things we dialed in. But the I guess the takeaway is that it's you can basically do everything that you need with one amp.
I am super impressed and I'm
cool.
Absolutely happy that you were here and you took some time for us. It's been a pleasure and I wish you good luck and
thank you.
All the best for the rest of the tour and overall.
Cool. Thank you, Kris. Been awesome. Thanks, Thomann.
Absolutely, absolutely happy that you were here. And you guys, you know what to do. If you want to, it doesn't hurt and it helps us a lot. If you subscribe there in the bottom and on the right side and share your opinions, we'll be back with some different stuff soon enough. Cheers, guys. Take care.